Welcome to Talentwise, the definitive podcast for CXOs, human resource and learning and development leaders. This show comes to you from thought leaders who talk about human capital development in today's organization. How to engage and empower today's employee to be effective, competitive and relevant. Stay with us for an exciting conversation with our guest and learn how to future-proof your team. I'm your host Shubhanjan, founder of Knowledge Bridge. Our guest today is Ritu Ranade, Vice President Sales at Software One India, a 10 billion IT services solution and platform company.
What's happening in today's time is the boundaries are thinning. The talent pool is accessible across the globe. I see scenarios where if there is a talent pool available in a particular country, it's much simpler to fly that talent than to source locally. That's the change. That's a very big change. And that means you're not only competing with your talent internally in a particular country or in a particular environment, but you have to become a global worker. Yep. That development is super important. That thought process is super important. That are you a true global worker? Have you built your talents and your skills? Or are you exposed well enough that your skills can be used across the globe? That's a very big differentiator today. I see this on a daily basis where the boundaries between countries are thinning. The process of flying people across to deliver to the customer the best of the services is most important. And hence, being a global worker is my third most important view that I would recommend that every leader, every team manager has to have on.
Ritu Ranade is Vice President Sales at Software One India and has a very deep understanding of customer buying behavior. She heads a team of 45 across India, driving 1,500 crores in revenue. She's leading the shift of the company from an on-prem software provider to cloud technologies. She also manages multi-million dollar portfolio of technology partnerships with industry leaders including Microsoft, Amazon Web Services, Google, and IBM. Now, on to this great episode of Talentwise with Ritu Ranade. Ritu, welcome to Talentwise. I'm excited because this is the first real discussion we are having about future-proofing the team with a focus on sales. We have not had many sales leaders on the show yet, so I'm really excited about this chat. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Shubhanjan. It's a pleasure to be here today.
You have had wide exposure to business and in the cutting-edge space. So I would possibly request you to start by, you know, defining what you think is future-proofing.
Right, Shubhanjan. I think I would like to go to the basics of this terminology. There's a lot of conversations, active conversations, if you read over the web and everywhere in conferences, in organizations about how do we make sure that our teams are future-proofed? How do we make sure that we're hiring talents or retaining our own talents, but who are effective in the future? I'm going to simplify this to all the listeners because that's how I started understanding this, the depth of this topic. If you go by the dictionary definition of future-proofing, it's basically a process of anticipating the future, and then you develop methods of minimizing the effects, if there are any ill effects, if there are shocks or stresses that come with those future. If you look at our daily human behavior, we do a lot of activities which is future-proofing ourselves. Let's talk about the insurance industry. If the boom is pretty much future-proofing on what we live today. If you talk about health, we always do medical checks to make sure that we don't have any ailments coming out of sudden. So as a practice, we have this, but now we have a different, we're at a very different cusp of how the environment or how the technology is making us think differently. So future-proofing is more about what do you expect out of your teams or your organization, the employees of the organization, so that we are adapting to the change in technology and we're adapting to the change of what customers are demanding.
How would you sort of cast it before we move on? How would you cast it when you sort of think of a sales organization within the organization?
Shubhanjan, let's look at what's happening currently, right? My fundamental question is here, why do we have to future-proof our teams? What's happening around us, right? And if we have that question, because we always have to think of why are we doing what we are doing, it's fundamentally very important to see that today, technology and humans are integrated to a very, very large extent. Everything, the larger jargons of AI, MI, to the RPAs and to the very simplistic things of we're moving to cloud, what's happening in that from a technology domain. But if I go to a non-technology domain, talking to health industry, talking to insurance industry, the automotive segment, I think they are equally being challenged right now on are the customers going to be happy with the product and services that they're taking into the market? And are these futuristic products? When your fundamental question rides about what you are creating today for the future, that means the people who are taking it to the market, the people who are designing it or building it, have to be equally capable to know what's going to happen in the future. So if you look at our current scenario, and as everybody rightly calls it right now, the fourth industrial revolution, it's fantastic to see certain infographics around it, where the fourth industrial revolution is about infusing technology with humans. And then obviously comes the fifth, which you're all getting ready for. In the fourth, we already are talking about moving to cloud. We're talking about using less and less of physical space and more of virtual space. It's extremely exciting if I look at it. It's extremely daunting for a lot of people because you need to be ready to be able to adapt to this change. And this one is a big leap as compared to all the revolutions that we have seen. This is intimidating most of the times because your skills are being questioned. Your capability is being questioned in real time. And what I see in the sales domain today is the pressure is a little different. You're talking to customers. If you're in growth organizations, and that leads me to the most important topic, right? Today's present scenario, the biggest challenge is every organization wants to have a growth mindset. And why not? Because that's the whole purpose of an organization existence. If you're focusing on a growth mindset, that means it's on the current yield and not the future yield, right? We have to look at how we are building it today. How are we investing in our talent today? How are we building the right products today to have a very long-lasting future? Could be talent future, could be pretty much the organization future. So it's a very, very exciting time, I would say, if people are very conscious of what's happening around them and not being intimidated by the change, but to really be putting themselves at the same plateau with their peers, with their supervisors, and say that we all are in the same phase, whether it's a CXO who has been questioned of what's the new product that you're launching, to an employee of a team to say that, are you certified or do you have the knowledge to talk about this in front of the customer? And it's when you talk about future-proofing, for me, fundamentally, it wraps up, it's most of talent risk management.
So I will just go back to the points you were making and look for some specifics. So when you are talking to the CXOs and CEOs, which you do very often, what kind of change do you perceive? And I'll qualify that question in a bit. That is, it's easy to say, is my employee or my talent which is coming in ready for the future? But as we all know, trying to define the future in an era like now is extremely difficult, simply because a lot of it is being led by computing, and the capability of computing and the layers that are coming in, a lot of it is happening elsewhere, right? I mean, the differences between an eBay and Amazon, a Craigslist and an Airbnb, right? So the application and the ability of that disrupting complete industries is not something we are familiar with. We have been, over the last 100 years, familiar with incremental change. So steam to electricity, so on and so forth, right? But this, the rapidity of this is really alarming from that context, right? So how do you see the CXOs and CEOs, what do you see them thinking, talking about?
I think you nailed it pretty much, Abhanjan. I think rapidity, you know, it's the speed of the way things are happening around us today. It's getting very agile, in true form agile, right? If you remember, let's say if you go 8 years back, agility or the word agile was just spoken loosely around developing codes, right? Today, it's becoming behavioral. We are talking about agility in our behavior, agility in adopting new things. The CXOs definitely, if I look at it, most of my conversation, the terminologies are constant across in industries. It's very, and all of this is putting a lot of risk on real-time decision-making. If you remember, again, if you go back a decade back, we had a pretty hierarchical structure of operating in most of the organizations where we had a board who decides, there's a CXO who decides. Today, I think every employee decides on how a company is going to get structured in the future. So it's a good importance across organizations that I see when I meet that they want to have user behavior into control. They want to invest in the user behavior while they focus on customer experience. So it's all about experiential impact that all organizations are talking about.
Let's take a short break. When we come back, we will discuss how HR has come back into focus and has become the core that is leading the change we see in organizations.
You are listening to a Show How To audio original. Podcasting is one of the fastest growing content marketing avenues today. We can help you exploit this largely untapped marketing opportunity. We can craft your audio strategy and leverage the wide reach and easy streaming capability that smartphone penetration provides. It is powerful and personal. Talk to us to find out how podcasting can help you build your brand and reach out to target audiences.
Welcome back. Before the break, Ritu was explaining how HR has come full circle and is now the epicenter of change in an organization. Let's continue to listen in.
What kind of talent risk management practices do you see being used today? Or and also, if you can actually tell me the before and after that you see, that like what were you seeing like a 3 or 4 years back vis-a-vis mm-hmm. what you see now?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's a very good comparative to understand what was happening in the past and what's happening today. I would start with a very basic thing, which I think I have a joke with my HR all the time. If you go back at least 5 years back, okay, I will not do it way back, but if you go 5 years back, HR division was always looked at a basic fulfillment division. Many a times there was a cross line between an administrative and HR division. But today I think HR is the most important function in any organization. Managing human resource has become very different than what it was a decade back. That's the first difference as I see, right? The second is, if you remember, if you go back again a decade back and you see there were clear divides on industry behavior, there were clear divides on how the end customer for that industry would demand something from the company. Today, there is no divide. You gave a very good example at the start of a conversation about the Ubers and the Olas, right? They've just completely changed. Anything which is based on a platform is unanimously acceptable to everybody. So we're looking at a single interface conversation. We're looking at a single interface. If you look at all of these great 5-6 examples that are the trend breakers in the industry, right from Facebook to WhatsApp to Olas to the Ubers to the Zomatos, all of them are platform-based, reaching out to the same audience at the same speed. They are not building solutions which are industry-specific. So there's a big shift between these two, if you observe, right? The last and the most important difference that I see, the employee base is more active, more vigilant, as compared to if I go to the pure play 20 years old system that was existing. We do talk about the millennials entering and we have to have a different approach to manage them. But I would still simplify it. It's not about the millennials. I think everybody is very conscious of what is the impact that they are creating as an individual, whether they are growing in the organization. And that comparatively is very different than what happened a decade back. It was more so, I am at an X role in an X company and I'm getting paid well. And that looked very nice. Today, I'm at an X role in an X company, but I'm not sure whether I'm going to have this with me in 6 months down the line. Am I skilled enough for the market that is changing around me? That's a big difference.
Right. So if I then break this up, that the talent risk management comes in, I would say, two or three layers, right? In the sense that what is the organizational view, what is the CXO level view, what is the managerial level view, and what is the end employee level view. Each have their own distinct thought process, right?
Absolutely.
So can you sort of elaborate on that?
Absolutely. Shubhanjan, that's the crux today, right? When we're talking of a change, when we're talking of the fourth revolution heading to the fifth, this is not a change which is happening in a silo in an organization. And if you see any success, first, obviously, there has to be a lot of culturally leadership-driven behavior when talking about like risk management. The self-awareness of the organizations, the self-awareness of a CXO. So it's important that there is a complete integration of these three layers, the designers, the executors, and then obviously the receivers of the whole process. So if you see today, every organization, and you can very easily point out, if you look at the top five ITES, you look at the top five FGE, typically I'll give you these five points that I use when I look at how I put a five pointer structure around it. And as I started my point, it is the first point is awareness. Awareness about, are we aware of the damaging impacts that the recent changes are doing to the teams? So that means the CXO needs to be aware of what's happening with its talent pool. The manager needs to be aware of what's happening with the talent pool. And the talent pool needs to be aware of, am I equipped enough to take my customers in a healthier conversation than only being general conversations about what's happening in the technology trends today? So the first most important is awareness. I have seen organizations, as I said, visiting a couple CXOs. There is a clear digitization need. But the lack of awareness that you need it at an X point of time doesn't lead the company's growth in the way they anticipate. So first for me is awareness. The second point that comes across as a leader or as a team manager is there has to be a very structured timeout for skill development. There's a learning, there is a lot of updating on self. And this is where the company starts playing. So this is where it is more so the organization stepping in along with the individual. So, right? So even if as a manager, I would want to put a structure to this thing, the employee has to be having an intent to be trained and the organization has to have a structured timeout. The third point, which I lead from here, is more of what's happening in today's time is the boundaries are thinning. The talent pool is accessible across the globe. I see scenarios where if there is a talent pool available in a particular country, it's much simpler to fly that talent than to source locally. That's the change. That's a very big change. And that means you're not only competing with your talent internally in a particular country or in a particular environment, but you have to become a global worker. That development is super important. That thought process is super important. That are you a true global worker? Have you built your talents and your skills? Or are you exposed well enough that your skills can be used across the globe? That's a very big differentiator today. I see this on a daily basis where the boundaries between countries are thinning. The process of flying people across to deliver to the customer the best of the services is most important. And hence, being a global worker is my third most important view that I would recommend that every leader, every team manager has to have on. Which leads to the fourth most important point that I dwell on, and I instill this on an everyday basis with my team. It's a little tough one. Sounds a little philosophical, but I would definitely park it here. It is more of developing resilience. It's a time of change, right? You have a resistance, you have myths about change. You come up with a connotation which might not be true or true, and the point is time is limited. So it's extremely important that you're looking at resilience as a quotient to be built in yourself in this time of developing yourself as future proof. Right. And resilience in itself, if you would agree to, I think today, since everybody is being challenged on what are the skills that are unique to them, you have to have a lot of patience in building and investing in yourself, exposing yourself to a lot of projects or areas which are completely new, because that's the future. We are looking at people who could do things differently, have different thought process, and hence your aspect of being resilient in learning different things is extremely important. So developing resilience for me is at number four. We need to be very mindful about it. And obviously the fifth mantra, the fifth point that matters, and we should be paying enough importance to it as well, is about wearing many hats. There is no boundaries in hiring anymore. If you see, we don't say that I'm going to hire an experienced person, but that experienced person can come from any parts of industries. Has this person done customer engagements? Has this person done team management? Has this person done different roles in his past life? Yes, it's multifaceted. We go and hire these people. Or even internally, if you have a resource who has displayed while in the core job, going above and beyond their functionalities, then that becomes a very super important talent, because you are definitely now looking at a person who can wear many hats. It could be moving internal roles. It could be skilling to become more complete in the domain that you have, right? I think the change in today's time is, if you're doing a function and if you really want to be successful, your team has to be successful, then it is about behaving as if you're owning a business and not about doing just a function. And that calls for wearing many hats. So that's my fifth point, which is super critical that we should pay attention to.
Wonderful. So I will actually totally agree. And let me just touch upon how it makes so much sense, the last three points especially. The factor that you mentioned about fashioning yourself as a global worker is very much evident from the rise of the gig economy, right? So you are, and you are talking of flying people. You are not even doing that. People are working remotely. I mean, I can name one particular company you will be familiar with, Zapier. Zapier has 140 employees, no offices. Employees work in 30 countries. Okay, everybody is remote working. So that's, I mean, how global? I mean, that's as global as you get. So I completely see that. When you talk of developing resilience, that too, in fact, I will say four and five sort of come together and not so much together. So the fifth one, wearing many hats, is also about a person with an agile mind. And I think that connects back to the agility that you are talking of, the agility of not as a programming approach, but as culture. I think having an agile mind is very critical. And in our generation, I mean, I think you will be one or two decades, after. But even from our generation, people who were wearing many hats were essentially demonstrating that in a pretty structured, I'll work for 20 years in a company, and that loyalty was critical, and that cultural sort of framework. Somebody who is moving out and wearing many hats showed agility. Yes, I see that point completely. And coming to resilience, I totally agree. And I think what you are voicing, the way I hear it, is that, you know, we have been talking here about your ability to learn. So the biggest skill that you can have as a employee who intends to be future-proof is to develop the skill set of learning new things, right? Okay. And resilience comes just packed together, because if you don't have resilience, you'll not have the mindset. You use the mindfulness bit, right? So you will not be mindful that if I don't have resilience, I can't pick up a new thing. And learning a new thing is the thing which will save you or not save you, right? So yeah, so wonderful. Great points. I totally dig them.
Thank you so much. I mean, and Shubhanjan, to give a realistic view of what's happening across, right? Technology industry is driving most of the changes, is the way it's perceived. I would actually reverse it. I would say that the customers across are driving the change the way we want. Look at how you procure today. You would always want to sit behind a screen and order your food or order your car or order your clothes. And then obviously there is somebody who is fixing a model around it to be delivering you, right? We are reducing the time to get to everything that we want. But when it comes to talent skill development, I think people are a little more cautious. I would say it's super imperative right now that you try doing different projects at the same point of time. You know, the new theory of fail but fail faster is something which is super important. Resilience comes with that. This is about the capacity to recover quickly, right? That's the fundamentals of resilience. So if we can package all of this, I'm sure people will be able to make it more easier. I myself try and set some time off to do that learning curve that I wish I should go through. And then, yes, it's extremely tough because you have so many other priorities that take shape and form before it, right? But then the more I push myself to be more structured, I think that gives you a better understanding of what psychologically people are trying to push back, right? We are used to going in a structured frame of learning. I finish my 10th, I have to do my 12th, I have to do my grads, and then, you know, I am structured till post-grad. What after that? Nobody gave us a view at the time. So now it's very self-driven. You have to be extremely motivated in the current times to actually build your skills and make yourself first future-proof. Look at your teams, make them definitely future-proof, which has a great impact on your performance.
Wonderful. So before I let you go, I would just want you to tell me, do you see the shift in the mindset of sales leaders that fundamentally, you touched upon something just now about the customer being in charge. One of the thoughts that I talk about is that it's very evident that the selling buying process has the control or the initiative has shifted from the supply side to the demand side. Buyers are far more in control of the process than they ever were, and yet the lot of the discourse that you hear even today are about the old way of selling, right? So do you see some change there?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the awareness quotient is very strong right now. I think it would have instilled pretty much, I would say, about 5 to 8 years back, where the community is aware that the customer driving seat, the true form of, you know, the mantra that's taught to every seller that customer is king, is reality today. The initial time was customer was a king from only demanding a price. Today's time, the customer designs your products or services and says, hey, I like your product. I like from A to B and B to C, but I wish your product also had 1, 2, 3. If you go to really large product organizations, they have this global go-to-market strategies with the services firm or the consuming firms to basically keep delivering and optimizing their product, which is more customer-centric, right? And that's a very big change. And when it comes down to having conversations with customers today, I think it's more of a handshake between the customer and the service provider or the product provider, where we understand that there is a fitment of the customer's scenario with the product and services, but there is more or needs to be done to increase the CX quotient, right? And then customer experience is all about how close and how specific can you get to their demand. So there's a lot of pressure points at this juncture. There is a lot of agility, again, leads back to the same thing. A lot of agility that is required by organizations. I have fantastic examples in front of me where I have seen large product organizations who are, and I would like to give examples. If you look at the way the Googles, the Amazons of the world are working, they are typically creating customer-centric conversations, right? Behaviorally, they are designed as customer-first. And then we have other product giants, which are saying that the product is fantastic and the customer has to adapt. Obviously, the transformation is very slow. So today, even if you look at the startups, which are having a consumer mentality, are platform-based, have fantastic growth ratios and product expectations from the customers as compared to what it used to be in the past. So yes, there is a good amount of acceptance in the sales community, but it does do a lot of pressure points along with it.
Talentwise is brought to you by Knowledge Bridge. We produce customized and multilingual visual training content. We have worked on complex processes, products, and skills development for large blue chip brands such as Tata Motors, Mahindra First Choice, Home Lane, Epson, Toyota, Citibank, and Consul Neowatt, serving diverse industries. Talk to us for your next custom content requirement and be pleasantly surprised. Call us on 99021-631-32.
Well, thanks, Ritu. I really enjoyed chatting with you. And I would really like to get back to you. In fact, we are working on a completely different podcast called the Buyer Side Chat. And that, mm-hmm. that's focused on how the entire sales focus has shifted to the buyer and how it has become a buyer-led process. And I would love to have you in there and talk a little more on that.
I would be glad to do that as well, Shubhanjan. It was a pleasure.
Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you so much. You too. Bye-bye.
Thank you for being with us today on Talentwise. We hope we helped you focus on some actionable ideas today. It was certainly enlightening for us. We hope to see you again on our next episode. If you liked what you heard, subscribe to the show in your favorite podcast platforms like iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or wherever else you get your podcasts from, and give us a rating while you're at it. Thank you in advance. This Show How To Original podcast is produced for KnowledgeBridge, the multilingual visual training platform and custom training content creators by Show How To Audio. Hosted by Shubhanjan Sarkar and produced by Rajiv Aditya. See you next time.